Penguin Random House Canada presents Barry Squire's Full Tilt by Heather Smith. Read for you by Irene Poole. To the real Big Gord, who taught me to just get on with it, and always to Rob. Prologue. If this were my memoir, it'd probably begin with, "It all started at the bingo hall." There'd be a picture of me on the cover, my heels clicked together in midair, and on the back there'd be a blurb from Pope John Paul II saying, "The best damn book I've read since the Bible." The title would be "All Tapped Out," and underneath, instead of "By Barry Squires," it'd say "Written with Passion by Finbar T. Squires," in honor of Nanny Squires, because she was dramatic like that. But this isn't a memoir. Memoirs are for people who've lived long, amazing lives and have inspirational stories to tell. All I did was follow my dream of becoming a full-tilt dancer. And that went tits up pretty quick. Chapter 1. I'd seen the full-tilt dancers perform 1,000 times, but it wasn't until the opening of Frankie McCall's bingo hall that I wanted to be one of them. Maybe it was how their tartan uniforms glowed under the neon sign. Maybe it was how their shoes clacked on the large piece of plywood Frankie had put down on the pavement. More likely, though, it was because I'd spent the last year getting kicked out of every club and extracurricular activity I'd joined, and Nanny Squire said that if I didn't find an outlet for that temper of mine, I'd have a heart attack by the time I was 20. The parking lot in front of the hall had been cordoned off for the performance. Mum stood behind me with her hands on my shoulders while Dad, the good son that he was, brought Nan to the front to find a chair. I wished my baby brother Gord was there because he'd have loved the traditional Newfoundland music. But he was home with our older sister Sheila, who'd stayed behind to clear up after our big Sunday lunch. My other brother, Pius, wasn't impressed. "Stop being a saint, will you?" he said. "You're making the rest of us look bad." Pius, or Sweet 16, as Mom had been calling him since his birthday, had a big mouth and a comment for everything. When he'd heard that we were going to see the full-tilt dancers, he'd said, "Irish step dancing's for tools." As I stood in the crowded parking lot, mesmerized by the frenetic movements of the troupe, I felt like our Black & Decker 400-watt variable speed jigsaw, because if step dancing was for tools, I was the biggest one in the shed. Frankie McCall stood under his bright neon sign, tapping his foot and clapping his hands. "Look at him," said Mam. "He's like the cat that ate the canary." The Full Tilt dancers had been scheduled to perform at the One Step Closer to God nursing home, but McCall had lured them away with the promise of 5 free bingo games per person. Father O'Flaherty's Full Tilt dancers were the most sought-after act in the city, with the popular bagpiper Alfie Bragg and his Agony Bag being a close second. The bingo fanatics of St. John's had been thrilled to learn that Frankie McCall was building a new bingo hall. The parish hall, where the game was normally played, had a rat problem. Nan blamed the infestation on the Hawkins cheesies that were sold at the snack bar. "Finding one of those on the ground is like striking gold for a rat," she'd said. I agreed. I'd been known to eat a few off the floor myself. Bingo attendance at the parish hall had diminished, and when the town blabbermouth, Bernadette Ryan, called into the VOCM open line radio show to say that her 99-year-old bingo-loving grandmother was showing signs of the plague, runny nose, fatigue, weakness, people refused to go altogether. Our old parish priest, Father Malloy, tried to reason with his parishioners, saying that the place had been fumigated not once, but twice. But Bernadette would not be silenced. She said that fumigation wasn't enough, that during the Great Plague of London, contaminated bedding and clothes were burned to avoid contagion. Therefore, the rat-infested parish hall should be burned to the ground. That's when Frankie McCall stepped in with the news that he'd be building a new bingo hall on behalf of the church. On the day of the announcement, Father Malloy called McCall a great philanthropist. Mam said, philanderer, more like. When I asked what that meant, she told me to go ask my Aunt Telly. As far as I knew, I didn't have one. After the dancers' opening performance, Frankie gestured to the double doors, which were blocked off by a piece of yellow police tape. That's what you get, said Frankie, when you leave the village idiot in charge of the ribbon cutting. The village idiot was 94 and Frankie's mother. I sidled up to her. That son of yours is a hard ticket. Don't worry, she said. He'll get his comeuppance. Frankie made a cutting motion with his fingers. Where are the scissors? The village idiot passed him a pair of pink plastic safety scissors. I laughed my arse off and said, nice one, missus. Frankie broke a sweat as he hacked through the tape. On the final snip, the full tilt dancers did a celebratory step dance. The dancing was good, but Eyes the Boy was too obvious. If it were up to me, we'd have sung Bingo. There was a Frankie had a hollin' bingo was a game-o, B-I-N-G-O. Clearly, this troupe needed my out-of-the-box ideas. When the applause faded, I told my parents that my new life goal was to become a full-tilt step dancer. Not a chance, said Dad. We'll be drove nuts with the racket. But I have a feeling, I said. It's stirring deep in my loins. For goodness sake, Barry, whispered Mom. You should never talk about your loins in the shadow of the basilica. You just made that up, I said. They talk about loins in the Bible all the time. Dad ushered us toward the hall. Come on, bingo starting. Bingo schmingo, I said. We're talking about my dreams here. The answer is no, said Mom. You'll only quit after a few weeks anyway. And the last thing we need is you clicking around the house like a moron, said Dad. I picked up a rock and lobbed it at the neon sign. Well, screw ye all. The rock landed 2 feet short of its target. You're lucky you missed, said Frankie McCall. A move like that could get your whole family banned from the hall for life. So help me God, said Mom. If you screw this up for me, I'll disown you. She loved a good game of bingo. As we filed into the hall, Dad pulled me back by the elbow. What the hell is wrong with you, Barry? First time your mother leaves the house since Gord's been born, you have to turn into the Antichrist. I yanked my arm away. If you must know, I said, I'm Jesus's number one fan, and that, sir, makes me pro-Christ, very pro-Christ indeed. Don't sir me, Barry, said Dad. I'm your father, for Christ's sake. Taking the Lord's name in vain, I said. Now who's the Antichrist? I caught up to Nanny Squires, who was waiting for me at the snack bar. Every week she bought me a treat, my reward for helping her keep track of the 20 cards she played at once. Get whatever you want, she said. As I browsed, my stomach rumbling, she added, except Hawkins Cheesies. They started the plague, you know. Frankie Hall had done an outstanding job stocking the new snack bar. I was spoiled for choice. Look, Nan, I said, they even have Mae Wests. But Nan didn't respond. She was too busy marveling at the shininess of the new counter. I hope they use Comet on this, she said. It'll help keep the sparkle. I picked a bag of salt and vinegar chips, and we joined my parents at a crowded table. What's up with these cards? I said. They were different from the ones we usually played. They didn't even have the word bingo written across the top. Frankie wants to try 90 ball bingo, said Nan. He played it when he was on holiday in the UK, said Mam. Concentrate now, Finbar, said Nan. There'll be no letters called, just numbers. This is madness, said Dad. Pure madness. The four of us sat with our bingo dabbers, hovering over the cards, waiting for the caller to shout the numbers. The sound system crackled to life. Tickety-boo, 62. What the hell? Said Dad. Frankie McCall was standing nearby. It's how the British do it, he said. Doesn't it add another level of fun? Cup of tea, number 3. I recognized that voice. It was Uneven Stephen, the colourful Englishman who was a fixture in the downtown core.
Dirty Gertie, number 30.
What a load of old foolishness, said Mam.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.